Hi, everybody.
Aha.
Yeah, Veronica had it. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Vaginal Fantasy. This is a book club where me and my three co-hosts, we discuss a book every month in the vaginal fantasy genre. No, we're not going to talk about vaginas the whole time, although they will be mentioned. Maybe not with this book, but sometimes in general. But the books we discuss are usually romance novels with a genre twist, like Anita Blake or Twilight, not really, but you know those kind of things. Romance genre books. And I'm so happy to announce that my co-hosts are here because we are almost at our fifth anniversary. So for 5 years, we've been getting together doing this almost. I'll save it for our fifth year anniversary thing in March. But here is Kyla Casby.
Hi. Oh. I have a cold.
Can I just say, she sounded fine for the last 10 minutes while we were setting up. I don't know where this poor baby sick voice came from. She is sick, but she sounded fine, like just now.
She sounded much better than that. That was really, you're just really chumming it right now, Kyla.
We love you.
Yes, we do love you. What are you drinking?
I'm drinking whiskey. And then also I still have my Major Tom drink, which actually I think I should now name the Trump. Because it's kind of orange and big. But I don't want to drink Trump, so I'm going to keep it in Major Tom.
You do not want Trump juice inside you, okay?
Oh, yes.
Ladies do not like that. And then we have Bonnie Burton, who looks like she is literally from Spain. I love it. You look so adorable.
This is a new thing I have going for New Year's. I don't know how long it's going to last. It's basically me trying out new hair accessories and big jewelry and makeup regularly. And I'm still in my pajamas. Oh. Because I'm a writer, and we don't go outside unless we need to walk a dog or buy more wine. So I'm drinking this wine. It had a really pretty label. So that's what I'm drinking tonight. And before we continue, someone on our Twitter already asked if we could tweet out the link, the direct link to this. I don't have it, so.
Oh, the direct link? It's right here. It's always in the bottom corner here.
Oh, okay.
Well, YouTube page. Can you do it?
We'll see. Okay, I'll figure it out.
I just put it in the chat. Did you see it? Do you want me to email it to you?
Okay, I'll
email it to you.
I sent you a carrier pigeon with it on.
Yay, yeah. Be like Putin and send me a telegram.
Yes, by courier.
Courier? By courier?
That's, yeah.
I'll DM it to you, Bonnie. I'll DM it to you.
Okay, cool.
I just emailed it to you too.
Okay.
Oh my God.
You're gonna get this link.
I should warn the viewers though, I'm still recovering from my New Year's Eve drinking. I've never had an absinthe hangover. Boy, that was brutal.
Wait, what'd you do?
I was at a party and there was like a secret ingredient bottle of skull and crossbones. That should have been my first like red flag. And the bartender at the party was like, he's like a hipster mixologist. He's like, oh, it's a secret ingredient. I'm like, is it absinthe? And he's like, yeah. And so, yes, it was a strawberry cocktail. I know, I mean, come on. Bartenders always think it's like the super hipster, like.
I mean, there's only like 20 different things you can put in there. It's like that or peppermint schnapps or something.
You want to put a secret ingredient, put just a tiny bit of arsenic in there. That would really liven up the party. But no, I was just like, okay, well, I'll drink these drinks because they're good, but it had much absinthe and I didn't know an absinthe hangover was a thing until I had one. So kids, don't overdo the absinthe. Wine.
What was different about an absinthe hangover?
The absinthe hangover, I had like a brutal headache. And also, you know, when you kind of don't sleep for a few days and then you start seeing things out of the corner of your eye and you don't know, oh, do I have mice? Do I have a ghost? Am I entering a parallel universe?
That's all of the above.
All of those. So yeah, that's what I was convinced that I was like in like Stranger Things away type plot line. I was just like, this is not good. So I'm better. I'm drinking wine now. I know this is my friend now. So
okay, is it worse than a cocaine hangover?
No, because cocaine
for a friend.
Super depressed. I mean, I've heard that cocaine makes you super like afterwards because you're super confident and energetic, and then cocaine, like cocaine. I mean, in the 80s when we all did it. I don't know. Our next host is Veronica.
Veronica Belmont. We have yet to introduce her, but she looks amazing.
Oh, thanks. I just walked in the door. I didn't have time to do anything. So put some powder on my face.
You look great. You know
why you look great always.
You look great because you're not at CES.
Oh my God. I mean, CES, I went once. I was the ambassador to CES once. Yeah, it was actually kind of fun.
We hung out.
Yeah, we hung out. It was actually fun. I had a good time. We had a good time. But overall, it's just like going to Comic-Con times 50 because it's like it takes an hour just to walk across one showroom. It's so big. You can't even imagine.
You get your steps in, for sure.
There's no cosplayers. I mean, there's a lot more robots. I mean, definitely a lot more robots and, like, drones and stuff. But it feels like kind of like what E3, the video game convention, was, but without the, like, graphics. Like, it was – or Comdex. I remember going to Comdex, like, if any of you were watching Halt and Catch Fire. Comdex was, like, the boring
computer. Is that good? My friend works on that.
Yeah. Like, I love that show. Oh, my God.
I need to watch it.
Yeah, it's a good show because it's a strong female character. So I can't pitch Halt and Catch Fire enough. And it's on Amazon, I think, and it's on Netflix. So there's other places to watch it.
AMC, yeah.
But yeah, it's like, I just feel like I'm so glad. I write for CNET, and luckily I'm the one CNET person not at CES. So I'm like, I feel like grateful that I get to stay home with my dog, even though it's rainy in San Francisco. I do not have to deal with all the noise and all the like, bros high-fiving under drunk.
Oh, it's very bro-y. It really so is like E3. Tech bro world.
E3 is the same thing. It's like all these bros, and then there's just like the women who are there working are all like dressed up. And I'm just, when I was there, just like in, you know, like a t-shirt and jeans. And it was like, and it's just.
When did you go though? Because I've been to E3 and like, I feel like the gender, there's been a lot more gender equalization in the gaming, like non just, you know, people hired for the booze and stuff.
So the last time I went, you went the next day, I remember, because you went into the same, you got to do the Star Wars.
Oh, yeah, I did. That was fun.
Yeah. So I didn't get to do that.
I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. I got to do other stuff. So.
Can I say that I would really like us all at some point to go to the romance book club convention or the romance convention or romance writers?
I mean, we keep talking about it, but it's like, it's a lot. I need to, oh my gosh. Guys, Jackie, who used to work with me at Geek & Sundry, she left to another job, very excited for her. And she usually did the compilation thing for the local hangouts where I do it. Oh, so I forgot to do it. I have excuses. I don't feel right.
Yeah, do you want to talk about?
I'm not drinking either, by the way, but only because it's dry January. Don't get excited.
Oh, dry January? Is that a thing?
It's the kind of a thing. I'm just seeing if I can, yeah.
I think Kyla and I could drink for both of you right now.
I want to drink, but I can't. But that's fine. One month.
Yeah, you could
go drunk.
I mean, would anything really happen at this point? I mean, it's basically baked, right? Like,
they will get drunk. Although I really do want sushi. That's the one thing I'm like, I need sushi.
I had sushi the whole time.
I know. I just can't. I'm too neurotic.
We should
my doctor. My doctor
say something about what we're talking about, because no one, if people don't know, you're carrying another host.
I am. I'm having a baby in 3 weeks or less, hopefully. And it's also Jennifer in the chat's birthday.
Oh,
let's talk about that instead. That's pretty cool. No, I'm just really tired, guys. I just am exhausted. Look at me. I thought I couldn't be paler. It's happening.
Yeah, I think you're paler than I am, and that's like impossible.
I know, but it's also putting no effort in and wearing the same pants for 4 months. So
for people who don't know or who haven't been pregnant, the last like 3 months at least, you have insomnia the whole time, and it sucks.
Everything about it is pretty awful, and I admire anybody who's glowing. So it's fine, guys. It's fine. 3 weeks. I can literally count the days. It's going
to
be great.
And just to like let our viewers know, who keep commenting on our Facebook page when I made that, like I posted your announcement of that awesome picture with you, the trucker hat and showing your belly. Okay. All these people are like, oh, who's next? Veronica or Bonnie? And I was just like, well, you know, Veronica at least is, you know, married and has a dude. Who could probably
it doesn't matter though, because I'm not having, I don't want to have a baby, so that's totally okay. It doesn't matter if I'm able to or in a relationship.
No, I'm just saying scientifically, unless the next like Jesus happens, I'm not even dating. I'm not even.
Oh my God, it would be so amazing if you had the Immaculate Conception, Bonnie.
It would be amazing. Also, you have a really strong pillow collection, so I don't know why you're single.
the worst person to have a baby. Like my place is not baby proof other than pillows everywhere. And I forget to eat. So I can barely keep, the fact that my dog's been alive for 15 years is shocking. I mean, look at this.
You would be able to keep a baby alive.
Maybe. I don't know. Every time I play Sims and there's a baby, that baby does not have a good future.
Well, you deliberately try to kill people in the Sims, baby or no baby. Okay. That's just a problem. I lock them in the bathroom and I take away the door and then I take the toilet out.
Whoa. Yeah,
and they die because they starve and they pee themselves.
Okay.
Let's talk about the local hangouts. Let's give a shout out.
Oh yeah. Our show.
Yeah, the show. Okay, so the Vaginistas are meeting December 8th. Beers, Books, and Boobs are meeting on September. These are all people who met in December. So the Vaginistas met, who are a very long-running group. These are all local people around the world who get together and discuss these books that we choose, other books. Sometimes they play board games. They all seem like awesome people. So I'd like to give a shout-out to all of these people all of our members who organize their own things. Beers, Books, and Boobs met in East Lansing. They also did a white elephant gift exchange, which is awesome. The Viking Booties, they're from Sweden, and they're having a Google Hangout next week. Cleft of Shadow, we have a WoW guild, and it's a Horde guild. And they're hanging out the 3rd and the 4th for Dungeons and Book Talk. So they're probably online right now. Only Lefters Left in the Library met in the back. And they're also meeting, I think they met last night to discuss this book that we are discussing this month. Also, the Vaginistas are meeting Thursday, January 12th for Christmas. So it's like, guys, you don't have to be on time. It's fine. And that's it. Wanton Wisconsinites will meet on to the 12th as well. So if you guys, there are other local hangouts. Usually we have more. The Venus Flytraps also are meeting in Dayton. Sorry about that. So if you guys have a local, look online, there might be a local group there that's either inactive or maybe they're already doing it and they forgot to post. If you want to make your own, lots of people do that. We have them all around the world, as I just said. And we usually have more. I think the holidays slowed it down a little bit. So shout out to all those members.
Yay.
Yay. And then, I guess we could just get into the books, guys.
Sweet.
Yay.
So the book was my pick this month. And I picked it. Okay, so it's called The 20th Wife. I'm going to read the description and tell you guys why I picked it. Briefly summarize my thoughts, and then we can all go down the line and briefly summarize our thoughts and then go, down the line. Oh my gosh. Okay. Clearly, I need to be better about doing the notes next time. I will do that. Okay, so.
Well, you shouldn't.
You've got enough going on. We can spread the workload.
Oh, thank you very much. Well, Jackie did was my savior. Okay, so the book is called The 20th Wife, and Bonnie always has a physical copy. It's by Indu Sundarasian. I'm sorry if I mangled your name. An enchanting 17th century epic of grand passion and adventure. This debut novel tells the captivating story of one of India's most legendary and controversial empresses, a woman whose brilliance and determination trumped a myriad of obstacles and whose love shaped the course of the Mughal Empire. She came into the world in the year 1577 to the howling accompaniment of a fierce winter storm. Growing up on the fringes of Emperor Akbar's opulent palace, she falls in love with the Prince Salim on his wedding day. Even in that instant, as his royal gala swirls around her, Merunisa foresees the path of her own destiny. One day she decides with uncompromising surety that she too will become Salim's wife. She's all of 8 years old and wholly unaware of the great price she and her family will pay for this dream. And that is the shortened thing. And obviously, so the reason I picked this book is that the last 3 months we've read short, very fluffy books that were very more romance oriented and to mixed results. Some of them were good. Some of them had things that we had really fun with. And I just wanted something a little more substantial because I knew that we were going to have a little bit of a longer holiday break. And I was kind of in the mood for some history. And we had some great suggestions on the forum about genres. So we hadn't really done anything in this area, and we hadn't done any Roman stuff. So I found a couple books in ancient Rome that I thought were interesting, and then I started reading the sample, and they were all about like killing the animals in the Colosseum, and I thought that was a downer over the Christmas. So I settled on this book, and it got very good reviews. And I thought and I had no awareness of this time period, so I thought it would be interesting. I can't say that I think the book was amazing. I thought that the writing quality in the book was amazing. I thought the history was very interesting. I didn't think that the character was proactive enough. It was more telling than showing a lot. But at the end of the day, I ended up researching the Mughal dynasty a lot more. I learned, I had a lot more insight into this kind of the culture. This is an Islamic culture that ruled India for a couple hundred years, and I thought that was really interesting to learn about. And it was just a, you know, harem culture is always interesting. So I love the world building and the writing of it. The plot and the characterization were the weaker things, in my opinion. And that was my survey of the book, briefly. Veronica, why don't you go first? I always go left from right. Yeah, you always go left.
I was ready.
Welcome. Yeah.
I came into this kind of blind. I didn't realize it was a historical novel or a historical, you know, based in fact, until the end of the very end of the book. And so, you know, maybe I should have paid more attention to that, but I thought that was actually pretty cool when I got to the end and read kind of like the research that she had done into that era and about those people and kind of the dramatizations that she wrote around them and her own, like putting her own input into it. And so, of course, because it is a place in time, it did have some, you know, problematic things. And, you know, for us coming from a Western society that we're not necessarily comfortable with or used to, not necessarily making any judgment calls on that, but it was, you know, that was how things worked then, and in some places now as well. But like, I did feel like Marunisa, like she was weirdly strong and also not in so many ways. Like she kind of felt a little one-dimensional in her kind of like single-mindedness towards wanting to be married to this one guy who frankly didn't seem all that great. Like, even in the beginning, like she kind of sees him from a distance and she's like, oh, he's the one, I'm in love with him. That's understandable. She was like 8 years old. Like people kind of build up fantasies around people. But then like he's kind of an asshole like throughout most of the book. And yet she's still very like fixated on that whole idea. And he was just a total spoiled brat, which I mean, I guess kind of comes with the territory of being like a prince. But it was interesting seeing those that the royalty in the book kind of reliving the same mistakes over and over again. Like he tried to overthrow his father, then his son tries to overthrow him. It never really seems like, yeah, no reason at all in the chat room says he was totally, 20 something wife said he was a man child. It felt that's exactly how I was thinking throughout the entire book. I'm like, oh, he's such a man child, like grow up. But I agree with you. I think the writing was really, really good. I was able to visualize like so much of the scenery and the places and kind of the majesty of it all and the scale of it. So that was cool. And I felt like I learned a lot about the history of that time period.
The Tamaranian said in chat, it's like drive me crazy when Melissa Joan Hart is after Seth the whole time. He's actually a total dud.
Yeah.
Good point.
Yeah.
Yes.
Good point. Bonnie, what were your overview thoughts of this piece?
Okay. So here's the thing. Like I'm not really enamored with harem culture. It's kind of like sister wife type cult or multiple wife relationships where there's one dude and like a ton of wives. Like I have nothing against poly relationships. I have nothing against like to each his own. And I understand this is a cultural thing, but it felt like more like it wasn't really a romance and it was more about power and survival than kind of like a romance situation, especially when you are one of the wives. And it felt also like this must be what it must feel like when you're married to the ultimate like collector. You know what I mean? Like, well, here's the thing. Like Only Lovers Left in the Library, which is like they're fans of our show and they do their own version of Vaginal Fantasy Book Club. And it's really great and they do a great job. I listened to what they thought about the book before we aired tonight because I just couldn't get into the book and I wanted to see, okay, well,
maybe they read the book with us.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, maybe I missed something, you know, like maybe I just didn't get quite into it. Cause you know how I am with historical novels. If there's if it's boring, I just make one of the main characters like a vampire or werewolf and I'm fine. But like if it's just straight up, I don't really get into it. And I watched them and they said it was interesting because like you have to think of it in a different way of like I collect books. Like you can see some of the books behind me. I have a zillion bookshelves in my apartment. I have tons and tons of books. I have not read every single book. Like when someone comes to my apartment and says, oh, you have a lot of books. Did you read all of them? I'm like, no, that's the point. Like you buy a bunch of books, so you have your own library and you could read them at your leisure, right? I feel like that must be what for this like
bless you.
Who have harems, right? They have all these wives that they collect. This is a horrible thing to say, but they have all these wives that they're collecting. They don't necessarily like treat them like you would a mono on mono, like husband wife or wife wife or husband husband situation. It's like when you have like 20 people to choose from of who you want to sleep with, who you want to talk with, who you want to have dinner with, who you want to like do your finances with, who you want. Like, to me, I get it. Like, there's a certain person that fits each mold. So it's not, you don't have all that expectation on one person. So it's kind of spread out. So it's not that much pressure. I think it would be better if it was mutual, if the women could have dude harems. That would be awesome. But
I've never read a book about a dude harem. And I think that we need, someone should write that book.
Yeah, there's got, that's got to exist.
And it has to exist. Like, someone, like, any of our viewers that know of dude harem books, please tell us because I would
please link us dude harem books because we will pick that.
Yeah, but at the same time, it's the same concept. Because I mean, I'm bi, so I could like I could understand the idea of having many different girlfriends that meet each different kind of need. Like it would be great to have a girlfriend who is just really into like hardcore science fiction, so I could learn more about science fiction from that person that I'm dating, or someone
Linda whipping you.
Yeah, or someone. Someone who's like really into cooking could teach me how to make a decent paella, or someone that I'm dating like is really into taxes and they could do my taxes. I don't know. I mean, this is super selfish to think of a harem like you're just basically thinking of them as servants, which is probably why I'm not dating. But I just, it was just hard to grasp the romance of being in a situation where you're one of many wives. Like it just didn't. To me, romance feels like you feel special, you're one of a kind, you're the center of attention.
Veronica's she's dancing.
Oh, I'm just excited because I just wanted to get this in. Jessica says that Naveen Andrews plays the prince, the man-child prince, in the movie Kama Sutra that's based on that time period.
Oh.
And I love Naveen Andrews. So now I'm like, yeah. Oh, even though he was such a man baby, I kind of want to see like.
I want to see that. Did anyone see Lion? That guy is.
Oh, I love him. Oh, yeah. He's so cute.
Yeah.
Also,
anyway, I'm letting wine ramble, so go to another person. But I will get back to this concept of a harem as a romantic world building technique.
Kyla was trying Kyla very hard to say something.
You know, I'm fine over here. It's fine.
No, Kyla, talk.
No, it just was about that. It's just also in the movie Kama Sutra is the woman who plays, you know, the lady is the leader of the sand people. No, the sand snakes in Game of Thrones.
Oh my God. Yeah. I loved her. Did anybody watch Rome?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. That is one of my favorite series. It's so underappreciated.
She was on that series?
She was the wife of the gladiator, not the gladiator guy, but the fighter guy. And she had the kid. I was like crying.
Right when that part happened that we probably can't talk about, even though it was 10 years ago, but we should.
Yeah.
But when he did that thing to her.
Oh my God. Guys, oh my God. I highly recommend that show. Highly recommend it. It's so good. And I'm reading a book called SPQR right now, which is like the history of Rome.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a little bit slow, but there's some interesting things in it. But it evokes a lot of like, oh, I need to go. I want to go rewatch that Rome thing and I Claudius, which is amazing too. Anyway. Oh, okay. Yeah. Kyla, what were your general thoughts? And then we'll go back around to talk about characters a little bit more in depth. Okay. and also somebody mentions that a male harem book is the Laurel K. Hamilton Mary Gentry series.
Oh,
that's what I was looking up. I was looking that
of
up
course. Because of course, Laurel K. Hamilton.
Yeah, because the men are.
I stopped reading that after the third one, and I just got bored of the. I don't know. Maybe it got better.
It was because of all the orgies, wasn't it?
I don't mind orgies. It was something about it.
Wait, is it the one where the men were very, they were considered submissive and they're like delicate flowers and you have to, you know.
No, this is the one where basically she's a fairy princess and it's a race to impregnate her. And she gets like seven men and they all just like take turns banging her.
What is the book in that? Isn't that just like, I mean, that sounds relatively.
It doesn't sound like a series premise, but there's like a mystery, everyone.
Yeah. I mean, so it's not just like sequential.
No, she has them all at once and they all have to take turns. I just didn't understand the coordination. She'd need a secretary to schedule this.
What? You need, I don't know. There might be an app for that.
I'm sure there is.
Somebody tell us if there's a male harem app. Anyway, Kyla, what'd you think about this book?
As someone who read a ton of historical fiction while she was pregnant, because that is apparently a thing. So many women do it because you're like, well, my pregnancy is going to be awesome and my birth is not going to be like that. It's going to be.
It is depressing because SPQR, the whole thing is that 50% of children under 10 in Rome died. Yeah. So if you got to 10, you were an adult because it was so rare that you actually survive. And then all these, like literally, I think 10 to 20% of women died in childbirth. And they would have, I'm sorry, I'm being nerdy, but order to replace, because the death rate of kids was so high, each woman, in order to even sustain the population of Rome, had to have 8 to 9 children. Oh, that's just to like literally maintain the population because of the death rate of children. Anyway, go.
No, it was also during the Black Plague too, wasn't it? Like Europe was having such a problem with children dying.
Same with the little Ice Age that happened too.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, I'm sorry I didn't interrupt you.
No. This was very much like that. And I'm still reading historical fiction. I haven't stopped. I'm still doing it. I'm not pregnant. But I really liked it. And because I got used to the sort of worse historical fiction as opposed to the better historical fiction, you know, some was sexier and some was more boring and some, you know, dry. But I actually really enjoyed it. And I also, you know, I mean, I love this time period. I love the Kama Sutra and the you remember the third book, Kushal's book, where she had to stay in the Zenana, but it was the awful Zenana, the awful harem where dirty and stuff, but all the women fought and everything. So I think that's really interesting. It also kind of reminds me of in the Eye of the World series, Robert Jordan series, and then Brandon Sanderson, when the women, the Suldam and Dam, the ones that kept women who could channel. On collars and leashes. But they all lived in the same place. Or when the
you have such a good memory.
I'm trying.
I know. Like you remember when you need
words. And then when the people that lived in the desert, the awesome people that could run naked, they taught Egwene how to, you know, dream walk, whatever they were.
Oh yeah, the Aiel. Whatever. Yeah.
The Aeolis.
Remember when you had Tun or something, you did something wrong and you had something, so you owed this thing to whoever you did it to, and so they put you all in white or whatever and you had to serve. And they all lived together.
You know, you remember a lot about fantasy slavery.
I feel like Kyla is like, I don't feel like that she's just memorizing this stuff because she's a good, I feel like she's taking notes for some reason. And I'm not
I know.
There's kind of a difference between a harem and because Rand in Wheel of Time, he had three ladies and they were like, we'll just share them. And Egwene and Mina or whatever, the three ladies were like, we're cool with it.
Yeah.
Which
that's more like polyamorous.
It's written by Mormons. I mean,
poly's different too. Also, that's different than multiple wives. Like Mormon, like those fringe, because it's not typical Mormon, right? Fringe Mormon relationships that have one husband and multiple wives, those wives don't get it on. Like, it's not like a poly thing where there's equal sharing going on in the bedroom. It's like your Tuesday sex wife, and then there's a Wednesday sex wife, and a third. Like, they don't do orgies. There's no. And I shouldn't even.
Well, I mean, there's definitely books about that for
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, I mean, orgies are more like a party thing. But I mean, it's just, it's different. So it's not like you have poly and multiple wife harem things are totally different.
Yeah. I mean, like the name of it, Kylie, you were saying something. Sorry.
Oh, well, my friend Melissa just reminded me there. It's Gaishan. That's the name of the people.
In
the
Yeah.
But also what I do find very, there was another Zenana in Guy Gabriel K. When the one where they all forget the name of the country that was their curse, they couldn't remember.
Tigana. Oh my god,
yes.
It was my favorite.
Right? Oh and my so god. They were all nice, and she was the head of it, and she was the number one wife. But they were all nice to each other. But I thought that this is just very interesting, the power and different caste system, basically. Uh-huh. In the harem, I thought that was a harem. Okay, croissant. that's what I thought. I thought it was really interesting. I really enjoyed the book. I didn't care if the dude was stupid because I'm used to that from historical fiction, so I was fine.
I have to admit, I'm not a big historical fiction fan. When it comes to historical fiction romance. So for you guys that read it a lot, is that a thing that the lead dude has to be a total douchebag / doofus?
Well, I mean,
a lot of the time.
Let's move into the characters. We'll talk about the characters a little bit more in depth now. You know, to me, like, listen, you have, what is more realistic if you read in actual history when sons of like, okay, like a warrior will come and take over a country, and they'll be the emperor or the ruler, and they earned it because of, you know, their acumen in war or whatever, and then they raise their kids in this cosseted sort of, you know, basically Hollywood atmosphere, like, right? And then when they become
Instagram.
Yeah, exactly. And then when they become rulers, they're shitty
yeah.
because they have no real life experience. They didn't earn it through merit. And they become despots and they're coddled. They have no worldview. So let's just be honest. If Salim was actually a real warrior and not trying to like kill his dad all the time, would it be believable? Would he be like a Marty Stew, you know, kind of thing? Mm-hmm. Because in reality, the best rulers were the ones who earned it versus got it through.
Sexier. He would be sexier. Yeah. To me, like, it's kind of like Game of Thrones. Type thing, like I'm more attracted to kings that freaking are covered in blood and took the throne as opposed to kings that were born into it because their second cousins got married and they're hemophiliacs and they're stupid. Like I'd rather have the royal bloodline be because they fought for something, they brought in new people, whatever, as opposed to, oh, I was just born into this royal family. It's kind of like rich people, like people who earn their millions of dollars because through hard work or ingenuity or just a strong work ethic,
handed to you by your dad and then you lose it all and then you're bankrupt.
Well, then you have you have self-worth problems, you have self-esteem problems because you know you're kind of an imposter. I don't know.
That shows up a lot. Like I do read a lot of historical murder mysteries, not so much romance. And especially when it comes to like Agatha Christie, when she covers murders that are in the aristocracy, a lot of those murders are happening, obviously, because greedy kids and wanting the will, you know, to be set in stone with their name on it, which is also something that came up in this book of, you know, a son that just wants to kill off his dad and take all the riches and the power. But for me, I just feel like, you know, it's that generation that shows up in different romance books. Even Great Gatsby, right? Is that you have this privileged, elite, rich class of people that never had to work a day in their life for the money that they have. And so because of that, they're lost. They have no ambition. So because they have no ambition, they have horrible vices because they just don't have drive. They just don't have dreams. They're just rich and living their through their parents' money. And so for me, that's not an attractive character to be attached to. I'd rather care about like the rags to riches, or in this case, a woman who is basically trying to move up socially and financially and through power with what she's got. Like, she's a very savvy intellectual, like she knows how to read people really well, and she's trying to make the best of what she's got, and she succeeds, as opposed to people who have everything and have no ambition, no dreams, no drive.
Well, I just want to say I do have one point that Alvin made that I also kind of agree with, where he says you can be good at conquering a country, but shit at actually ruling, though, like Robert Baratheon in Game of Thrones. And so I think there is something to be said for people who grew up in that lifestyle and kind of understand what it takes to be a fair ruler potentially. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I mean, it can kind of go horrifically either way.
We're sort of going through that now, right? There's a big difference between being born into finance and having someone that is used to being like in charge and used to getting his way, as opposed to someone who earns it, who's someone who like earns the populace, you know, appreciation. And it's like,
well, yeah, there's a lot of history. I read a really interesting book recently about the history of Byzantium, which is really fascinating in a culture that is very underrepresented. Guy Gavriel Kay actually has a couple books set in Byzantium, but some of the best rulers in there were like, oh, they were like the younger son who stood quiet and then suddenly was like Shiv. And they always thought, oh, that's the booky, nerdy guy. And they became like the best ruler because they bode their time and they stayed out of the way and they stayed innocuous. So they weren't necessarily the warrior. They were the thoughtful one who took over when the warrior got his ass, you know, handed to him, and ruled for like 40 years and improved society. So, I mean, you know, it's all dependent. And Shannon actually made a good point in the chat that Akbar, like the Mughal dynasty, was very expansionist. They were always trying to take over countries, and the fact that none of his sons were really given the kind of responsibility to become mature great leaders was kind of his fault. And then it happened to him, and Salim's son turned on him. There was no reflection like, hey, I did this to my dad. No, he's like, God, this guy's an asshole. I'm gonna blind my son. So,
you know, the cool thing though is that when it starts happening to him, he's like, what son would do this? And it's
exactly.
Like, come on, buddy. Like, it's not that long ago. Like, it's the hypocrisy of it.
He was self-aware of that though. Like he said it, but then he did, like, he kind of recognized that too, that it was.
I just read a whole thing about, I know I'm not talking about politics, but this is more about, it's kind of about Trump, but not really. It's about Citizen Kane and how Trump really he thinks he's Kane. He really identifies with Kane. And the fact that basically, you know, Kane had no self-awareness. No, he had no idea how to look inside himself or self-reflect or look back and see how that could have influenced something else. Mm-hmm. And that's really interesting because I think without that, you can't be a good ruler.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know? Let's talk a little bit about Marinissa, the lead of this, because it's very interesting. I think the author did a good job. So this is a real empress she's like very famous in that she was the only female ruler during this time who got her name, her face put on coins. Mm-hmm. She essentially, now the end of this book, spoiler alert, it ends in their marriage. So it really misses the interesting time where she actually ruled in her husband's stead for like 20 years.
And that made me actually want to read like more of it, because I was like, you're ending it there? Like, yep. What?
I was so angry. I wanted to read the next one because that's when she really ascends to power. And if you read the history, the Wikipedia entry alone on this woman is amazing. Like, she, you know, you couldn't look upon the emperor's women, even the wife or any of the harem, without being killed. But like this woman would go hunting with her husband and like shoot, you know, seven lions, just sticking her gun out, you know, where people couldn't see her. Like, she was a badass. I don't like lion murder, but, you know, she was a very badass woman who really, she influenced culture and she influenced society and law, and she ruled in her husband's stead until she was kind of shunted to the side by one of the heir who basically built the Taj Mahal. So this whole this whole era is really interesting. The whole trilogy covers a really interesting thing. I wish we had gotten more into the marriage in this book, because it was a very long book anyway. But, you know, it's interesting the way that she kind of traces women and their position in this era in a pretty clear way from like when the dad wanted to dispose of her to the way that she's married off without really having a choice to her miscarriages. I mean, do you guys want to talk about that? Because she was,
yes. You know, it's so interesting because I thought it paralleled Eleanor of Aquitaine. It's just, I mean, I couldn't stop thinking of Eleanor of Aquitaine because it was the same thing. She was married off to Louis, you know, of France. And then she had been ruling Aquitaine and on her own because her father was ill. And then he suddenly takes over and just destroys any kind of peace that there was. They had total peace and he destroyed everything. And he wouldn't let her do anything. And she was hamstrung. And then finally gets rid of Louis, finds, you know, Henry, thinks, this is the man that's going to let me do my own thing. And it turns, you know, at first he does, and then it turns out, no, he's going to do the same thing, you know. And in between those times, she did have periods of being able to rule on her own, and she was amazing, and they loved her, you know. And she could outshoot, she could outfalcon them, everything. It reminded me of that so much.
Yeah, I'm sad that we didn't get to that era, which is the second book, and I think I might read it just for the fun of it. But what about her? You know, it's interesting because, yes, I don't like reading about a woman who is disempowered and her dad just wants to leave her, you know, in the cold because they can't afford her and she's a girl. And then that, you know, she's raised and her dad educates her, but nobody wants her to be educated really. So that's rare that she would be literate even. And then she's like, all she wants in the world is to be, you know, a princess in a sense. And the harem culture where like they had hundreds of women who would only see the guy maybe once. And then when they're 30, they get like, get out of here, you're dead. So it is very disheartening because it's not an empowering kind of atmosphere to be a woman. You know, you could never be looked upon by other men if you were in the harem. Women were not supposed to be seen. It's very interesting, the same thing with the Roman history. Roman wives got screwed, dude, like the rich ones. You weren't supposed to look on them. And so it's not inspiring, but then is it really, you know, it's not historically accurate to retcon it and be like, oh my God, women actually had agency, right?
Yeah.
So I don't know. What are your thoughts about that in historical fiction? And, you know, is it more fun to read like reversionist history where women actually have an agency in these kind of settings?
Well, yeah, that's kind of what I mentioned in the beginning. It's like, it was frustrating because you could see how smart she was and you wanted her to have agency. And yet you knew that it was trying to be accurate to the time period as much as possible and the actual historical context. But it is like, you almost want it to... Well, I was thinking about the Mary Russell books by Laurie R. King and how, you know, Mary Russell, who's like in this other version of the Sherlock canon, is like a very smart young woman who kind of becomes Sherlock's apprentice. And she does all these things that are very unusual for the time period. So even though she's not based on a historical, you know, person, she is based on a very real time period, and she had a lot more agency and like kind of figured out a way to do it. So maybe I just felt like, if she had the desire to be like the behind the scenes queen and like get a lot done, but she didn't have this weird kind of like obsession with him, I think that would have maybe made it easier. If she was purely about the power, like she's like, I want to be behind the scenes. I don't care if he's my political puppet. Like I can do my own thing. And she did, but she also still had that kind of aspect of just being kind of obsessed with him in a way that was kind of a turnoff for me. But who am I to judge? Oh.
I mean, I have to agree with that. Like, I mean, it's interesting, like, to think of this character, like, would you consider her a feminist character? You know, and it's not really, because she's still obsessed with this guy, but she also, to me, she's an interesting character because she's working within the system to get what she wants. And this is a hard system to live in. Like when you're part of a harem and you're not the woman in charge of the harem, you don't have that much power. You don't have that much say. You don't really have any influence. And with this main character, I really liked the fact that she was savvy enough to get this guy's attention in interesting ways. You know, and like I said earlier.
Well, she refused to be a part of the harem. She's like, I'm not going to be your mistress. You got to put a ring on it. She's exactly, like right? Beyonce, like put a ring on it.
But she, like, got him interested in her in different ways, like releasing the birds and all that stuff. And so for me, I really liked her because in a way she was working within the system, which is not an easy system to work within. And also she's, even though she's obsessed with this guy, she is kind of, she still has her eye on the prize. Like, you know, to say, oh, I want to be a princess seems kind of silly now. But back then that was like, she wanted
how much do you have power back then, especially in this seemed like a very, you know, this is Islamic culture. You know, it was very interesting to see that because I didn't even know there was an Islamic dynasty in India at any point. Oh, yeah. And it was so incredibly powerful. So that was like really cool to see.
And I like that she was, you know, she's not power hungry per se, but like I said, the story feels more like instead of a traditional romance, it feels like a romance with power. Like she really wants to like, you know, get to a certain stage and there is a, you know, an actual, you know, way to get there. And I don't know. It's like there were certain moments in the book where I was like, oh, that's super romantic. Like, it's not, it's a slow burn book. So it's like it takes forever for them mm-hmm. to even like connect. And the fact that his first gift to her is a book, as a book lover, to me is like, oh my God, that's super romantic. And most people that would read this book would be like, what the hell? Like, how is that?
Is that cultural though? Because Bollywood movies, like, They never do it. They only, right. It's like the kiss at the end, but a lot of the times they don't kiss. It's just the end is like a fake out kiss.
It's very Victorian in the sense of, oh my God, our hands are touching. Like it's like that.
Yeah, that's like the big move. So maybe just the cultural influence of her being from India. I don't know. That's kind of interesting. Oh, I agree with you. We could have told this story in half the time and it would be fine.
Well, also like it does feel like a prequel. Like, I do agree with you. I think the second book is probably the more interesting one as far as the characters and the dynamic and what she gets out of it. This one mm-hmm. felt like there were times I'm like, okay, this is describing things taking a little too long. Or
yeah.
I want them to hook up. Like, I want them to connect more. I want there to be moments where there's more interaction between the two of them instead of, you know, he's like kind of weird stalking her in a way, like every once in a while. Like, it felt like there needed to be a bit more passion. But the book had great language, great descriptors too. I mean, I ate a lot of food while I was reading this book.
Yeah. Oh yeah. It was beautiful. Yeah. The colors and everything. Yeah. I did like the fact that whenever she ran into him, she was very deliberate. Like she wasn't like, oh, don't look at me. She was like, oh, what? You know?
Yeah. Yeah. I was ready for this.
She made the moments more.
She really did. Like that was probably one of my favorite parts, how kind of like sassy and catty she got, especially around that other bitch wife.
Oh yeah, Jaheen or I can't remember the name of the
day. Yeah, she was awful.
She was awful. I want to read the second book just to see how she takes that bitch down.
Yeah. I was over the holidays, I was binge watching because I had ran out of shows to watch because I binge watched everything good on Netflix. So now I'm on Hulu watching Real Housewives of like Atlanta.
What?
Atlanta ones are dumb. I love Beverly Hills and Orange County.
Yeah.
And
I think I like neurotic, those
and Vanderpump Rules.
Neurotic rich white women are boring to me now, so I need to diversify.
They are boring. It's true.
Atlanta to me has more sass and culture. So anyway, I'm like watching that. And then as I was reading this book, I was like, oh my God, this could totally be, I mean, this is a horrible thing to say, but Real Housewives in a way, because there were moments in the book where I'm like, oh, there's going to be something flapping. Like, I wish there had been more.
I think I would like to see a more bitch slappy harem book.
Yeah.
You know,
like if there was like real harem of like type of that would be
real great. Harems.
Yeah. And also I felt that I was like, as I was reading this book, I was getting closer and closer to being more interested about gossipy eunuchs. Like I want a whole book.
Bitchy eunuchs. Yeah. I mean, it's like Varys in Game of Thrones is my favorite character.
Yeah.
Varys knows everything.
A bitchy eunuch book series, I would be all over that.
Well, he's got a reason to be bitchy. I just wanted to say that I looked it up and made sure. Same time period was the Borgias. Yes, it was their time period. And so it was the reign of the Borgias. And I don't know if you watched that on
the TV. Show.
And it is true that Lucrezia Borgia, she could, I'm just doing bad accents. Just
like, oh, what are you talking about? I had a meatballs for dinner. It was a perfect.
Lucrezia Borgia.
I love it every time Lucrezia tries to do an accent. It just sounds like a drunk Australian.
It's like kind of Irish Jamaican. And then,
so what about
back in the base.
Okay. Slap in a bass.
Slap in a bass. So anyways, so Lucrezia, she really did do all of those things. She really did have all those lovers and killed lots of people. And she just did whatever she wanted to do. Maybe her brother, I don't know. But she rebelled.
That's why I didn't like The Crown. Did anybody watch The Crown? The Crown
is really good.
Yeah, it's good.
I love The Crown, but we call it the encoldening here in our house.
It's just so slow. I stopped after 2 episodes. I was like, ugh. And then everyone tells me it gets better, but it just felt like Elizabeth was just such a milksop.
Yeah,
she gets colder and colder, and Philip, Matt Smith goes, he's way back there, just
watch
in the
it.
Back going, why can't I fly my planes?
Ow!
So I like it. I'm excited about Victoria, the one with.
I just put it on the TiVo for the PBS. It got not good reviews. I don't care.
I like how I just screamed in pain and no one said a goddamn thing. Thanks, jerk faces, jerk sluts. It's okay. I pinched myself with a pinchy thing that I play with when I'm sitting here, and
we'll play with my skin. Thing.
It's just whatever.
Why are you self-mutilating on camera?
I play with things, and I just like tiny biscuits, for example.
Ian Albert heard it.
Can we bring up one of the characters that I was curious what you guys thought of?
Yeah.
The head lady in charge of the harem.
Oh, yeah. What's her name?
Requia.
If any book needed a pronunciation guide, this was it. Because it had a glossary, and it had a family tree, and it had maps. It even had, at the end of the book, an interview with the author to explain characters, but it still did not have a pronunciation guide.
Which one was the one that stole the baby?
Oh, stole the baby? Oh, she stole the bitchy wife of Salim's baby.
Yeah.
That's her. Rahanama Hanaha.
Yeah.
That's her. I don't know. I don't have the book. Bonnie, what you have the book in front of you. Dig it out. It starts with an R.
Okay, I'll find it.
R-Y-Q-Q.
Yeah. Discuss it and I will find it.
Yeah. So I
loved her, though.
Where is it in the book? Like towards the middle or? I forget.
She's all that through it.
She's all through it. Yeah, she's like, she was awesome.
Okay, I'll find it.
Akbar's wife.
R-U-A-Y-Y-A.
It's R-U.
I literally just said it. It's R-U-Q-A-Y-Y-A.
Thank you. No reason at all.
No reason at all. Thank you.
Veronica.
Rukaya?
Rukaya. Oh, that's kind of like Kyla.
Thank you, Jessica. Yeah.
I would totally steal a bitchy lady's baby if she wasn't treating it well.
Jagat Goscinny. That's the bitchy lady. Jagat Goscinny. The first wife, the preeminent wife of Salim.
The prequel wife.
Yeah. Rukaya. Mm-hmm. She was amazing. I think she was a good example of like, yes, you can have power in these situations. You're not going to get the glory, but you are able to influence in a great way while her husband was alive. And then she kind of got pushed to the side.
Mm-hmm.
What did you guys think of Akbar?
He seemed nice.
I think it's a trap. I think he's a trap.
It's a trap. I know, right? It's such a hard thing. Like, I always seem to think Admiral Akbar, or wasn't there an Akbar in the
Simpsons guy. Yeah, he had the Akbar. Cole
says Rukaila's harem race.
Yes.
Oh, wow.
I would totally be into that.
Okay, here's a question that's a little off topic, but not. If we all had harems, dude or female, doesn't matter, what would we want in our...
Oh, yeah, let me see if there are any questions in the forum we can go to. Yeah, what would we want? I would want a one of each from Skyrim.
You and your lizard men.
I don't want humans in a sexual way. I want dogs, just every different breed. One of every different breed, totally non-sexual.
I love that you want a non-sexual dog harem.
Yes.
You could have that, actually.
You can have dog that.
From every breed.
I think the pronunciation of that is called kennel.
A kennel? A kennel? No, but like free range.
Kennel.
Okay.
Like free range.
Free range.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
They taste better.
I feel like I had to make that really specific, that it was like a harem. But not a sexual thing. Set that up first.
You don't want to have sex
bring
with a
in
pug.
A dog.
Let's just be very clear. Yeah. No pug sex. Okay.
I want to really clarify that.
I would love a male harem, but I want them in a separate, like I want to have a very vast estate and make them all live somewhere else. Like I need my space. Like I wouldn't want like to have like 20 guys living with me because that's, I've had some similar situations in college and it's not fun.
They're not clean. You need to clean. You need to like get the Lysol out more.
I would need a lot of movements if I'm dating 20 guys at once. Like I need like a whole cleaning crew. I need a whole like kitchen crew. Like I don't want to be in, because then you turn into den mom pretty freaking.
Yeah. No, you're making nachos and they're sitting around and then it's like, well, your turn for the pee pee.
Yeah. No.
Yeah. No. No.
In a different part of the castle or estate or wherever I'm living, and then.
Well, yeah, they have the quarters.
Yeah, and then
the quarters.
Yeah.
Yeah, where they work out, or if you want dad bod guys and they don't work out, or if you whatever you like, you know, that's.
Like, I just want everybody. I would like, want a cat man and a lizard man, and then I want all of them to have a different accent. That's why I like the cat man. The cat man in Skyrim had that sort of like vaguely Romani kind of thing going on. That's hot.
I can only do one. I think I only have one decent accent, and I can only say one thing in the decent.
Do it.
Do it. Do it.
For fuck's sake! For fuck's sake!
That's pretty good.
For fuck's sake!
Okay, I could do quit your mooing. I could do that.
I did again what you're talking about. That got bad. That got bad.
It got bad. I've been playing way too much Hearthstone for some reason. I got addicted to it just the last 2 weeks. Hello, 4 years ago. But there's that one dwarf guy, and he's always like, I can't say it.
Yeah.
But it's pretty funny.
Say it.
He says, like, welcome to the.
Yeah, no, I must say.
Whatever it is.
Hey, okay, we have a couple of questions.
Wait,
I
didn't
get to talk
about my harem.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, Kyla's harem.
Kyla harem.
I am. Okay. I have thought about this many, many times for many years. So
she's been
waiting.
Why do I feel like you have a whole journal dedicated to this? Like it's a world-building harem journal.
I would if I could. Okay. So the castle is kind of like in Mirror of Her Dreams, right? So like I've just arrived and I'm like super hot. And my hair's like, and then there's like the captain of the guard, and then there's like the prince guy, and then there's like a couple other guardsmen, and then like a magician guy, and then like they're just like all trying to get with me, right? Mm-hmm. You know, there's like a horse, the captain of the horse or whatever, and the
wait, there's a horse?
No.
Let's just assume all involved animals are non-sexual. We'll just go with that.
Into like BoJack Horseman.
They're in charge of the horses, and so they're all just trying. And then it's just like a never-ending them all trying to be with me, and I just I never have chosen. I've had this fantasy forever. I've never, and the guys kind of switch out. You know, like there's like Sean Bean, and then there's like Christian Bale, and then like you know, like it's changed.
Taste change.
James McAvoy, you know, like everything like that.
I mean, like a Wattpad series that you need to write about.
You're being a harem tease, though.
I would just never kick them out.
I'd do it with them. I'm just saying
you can't keep the harem happy if you're just like basically. Playing them against each other the whole time.
What'd you say, Veronica?
Oh, I don't remember. I was saying I would invite them in. I would never kick them out. Like they could stay there and live their lives, and maybe we never even do it. Like it's I'm talking about humans again, not the dog.
Yeah.
I just want to be clear. I context switched there.
So that would be your sexual harem, not your non-sexual.
That would be the same. Yeah, this one we're talking about Kyla's. If I were to, for some reason, take over Kyla's harem because she was unavailable for a short period of time,
I was off doing important things.
Right, and I would just like. I invite them in, but, you know, and maybe it's just, you know, you just want to give them a nice home, a nice place to be.
I like that
you take a nice bath with them
just
and
take
they
a nice
wash
bath. Like maybe one of them's really good at massages.
Yeah.
100%. I would need a lizard masseuse, man.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. If you're going to have a harem, you better make sure one of them can give good massages.
And an accountant.
Yes.
Stephanie says, a sexual harem just wants to hang, yo.
Yeah. You can have to hang. An accountant and a harem. Big. You don't have to have an accountant in your harem.
Well, yeah.
Both.
I do.
If I want a doctor, okay, find you a man who could do both.
Yeah.
Like doctor, accountant, chef.
If I'm going to keep my harem, like, happy, I need at least one guy in charge of the finances, or else we're all going to be a homeless harem, which is just sad.
I would have a girl in my harem too, guys. I wouldn't just have all men.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
If we're going to go into a harem, like, you know, come on.
I'm going to go there. I mean, like, maybe, you know, like, I would have a lady in waiting that was also my lady.
Like, maybe my girlfriend sometimes.
Yeah.
That's fine. Whatever.
Exactly. BFs.
Yeah.
Right? Like girlfriend, like girlfriend. Like, you know.
Yeah. Having a commune, but everyone bathes.
Awesome. We make out.
Yeah, I mean, totally sometimes we make out. Sometimes we don't.
It's like and a cool. Like, yeah, it's like a cool.
She does your hair.
Yeah. Her style is so much better than mine. I can borrow all her clothes all the time, and like she just she knows how to do like the perfect French braid. She's really good at it. Just
well, I would have that. Well, then I'd have to have two girls. I would have to have French braid girl, and then I'd have to have like a Ronda Rousey girl.
Yeah.
To wrestle.
Like my workout buddy.
Yeah, yeah exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I would need one with magic that was able to, like, after I get out of the bath or we get out of the bath, then she's able to, like, do my hair for the whatever thing we're going to, but get it dry, like, super fast with
Well, they use that Dyson. You get that Dyson dryer now. That
is
has,
that good? I want one.
Is that a real thing?
I've heard mixed things.
Mm. What is this dryer technology sorcery you're talking
is
about?
It like Dyson, a flow?
There's a new Dyson hair dryer.
Hair dryer.
Is it like the vacuum people?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So what does it do? How is it better?
It just looks, it's smaller and it's kind of like that fan, you know, that they have the fan that doesn't have a blade. It's kind of like that kind of thing, right, Veronica?
Right.
Yeah,
it like sucks air through.
Yeah,
you don't need the filter, so it doesn't heat overheat. Is that what they're
like? Empty. It's just like a tube. It's pretty neat.
Yeah, I've been waiting since the 80s to get my like Blade Runner dryer situation going. Like you remember the Snake Lady when she goes and she undresses and just takes a shower, and then she's in that tube where like there's air going, so she like. Instead of a towel, well.
Oh, yeah, it's an air thing, which is very inefficient. Like, that's not a thing in the future. I'm sorry. Towels will be a thing in 100 years. Bark by words.
I mean, we're always going to have towels, but I kind of like that tube thing in Blade Runner where she stands at it and her hair dries the same way her body
dries. I feel like that would never work on bangs. Like, you got to really blow dry those flat.
You're right. You're right.
Yeah, it would be a bad scene. Okay, so we veered a little bit.
Yeah.
I mean, unless the air shut down, then your bangs would, your fringe would go down straight.
Yeah, you need the air shaft to go down.
You still would have to smooth your hair. Cool. Like, bangs don't just happen, guys. Look at Veronica.
you have to blow dry them straight, and then you have to either, this is a really good tip, put on a really tight, like, knit cap.
Yeah.
And then let them cool under the cap, and then take the cap off, and they'll stay like that.
Here's a weird,
you told me that before.
Here's a weird trick. Yeah, you don't have naturally, if you don't have naturally straight hair and you have bangs.
Yeah, because I don't.
Because my hair is like crazy wavy curly. The way I straighten it is like after I water it down, I take a bobby pin and kind of like put it off to the side and do that.
Oh, I do that too. Yeah.
Down like that.
And we should probably wrap things
up.
Stop
it. We're talking about
Hair tips are important, Veronica. We don't all have hair like Kyla. Sometimes we need some help.
I know.
Yeah. Okay. Kyla was sick. We're fine now, but we are going to take a 2-month hiatus. And I apologize for not being able to do our 5th anniversary at the end of December when our 5th anniversary is. But listen, we've been live streaming for 5 years. That is before live streaming started, guys.
Crazy.
Live streaming hipsters, like now live stream is all hot. Hey, we've been using this crappy Google Hangout interface for 5 years.
We're so lucky that it's still even here.
I know. It's like we're the only people using it. That's why all these trolls show up. It's like, hey, there's one thing live broadcasting.
Right? Otherwise, we'd be like on a phone tree. We'd be like, join our phone tree.
Yeah, phone tree. Exactly. But I'm very excited because we're taking 2 months off for me. I'm going to go away and I'll come back and I'll be skinnier, which will be nice. And then we will have it. So we're not going to pick a book for the hangout in March. I think we're just going to talk about our favorite books. Unless
Sean did pick, they're doing an alt thread
Sean Sandabuki Luke is the most amazing mod you could probably have for a group. Yeah. You keeping us on the rail, Sean. Joey Couture is doing a trailer. He released a trailer for the video he's going to do to celebrate our fifth anniversary. So we'll watch it on air. And so, you know, on the forum, just
Sean didn't do that, right? Joey did that.
Yeah, she said Joey Couture.
Is doing the trailer. Sean is wrangling everything and getting. And so I'll read the comment, you know, all the comments, and we'll discuss, you know, all the things, and we'll take questions from the audience, and we'll talk about our favorite books over the years. And then we'll get back into it and choose a book for April. So it'll just be a fun, informal kind of celebration at the end of March. And
I'll accidentally invite everybody to the hangout again. Would that be fun?
Yeah, remember that? That was pretty great. Awesome.
That was awesome. That would be so much fun.
I will say that during our hiatus, because I missed Nana Ramo, the wine is starting to kick in, so I never say that right. I'm actually writing a romance novel after reading How to Write Romance Novels for Dummies.
Oh my God. Please update the forum.
Yeah. So I'm actually writing it, and I'm putting every single cliche, but every single character I've always wanted to write a romance novel. So there's like Cthulhu is in it, and it's got like Nick and Nora kind of 1930s dialogue. And it's going to be, basically, I'm writing the book that I would love to read. I have no idea if it's going to be good or any idea if anyone else wants to read it. But as soon as I'm done writing it, I will make it a live link for everyone to read on VagFan during our hiatus. And I would love to get feedback. And if it sucks, that's fine. Like, it's not going to be, this is not like, this is my first real romance book I'm writing. So it's probably going to be crap. And it's going to be like wacky races of erotica, but I don't care. I'm going to try it. So I'm putting that out there. So if any of the viewers or any of you guys want to read it,
post on the forum. And I think there's a creative writing forum in the forum. And then so basically the main is the forum picked a January main. It's a Deanna Raiborn book, which is amazing. I read it when it first came out, and the sequel just came out. So I'm going to read the sequel along with
you. Oh, is it a perilous?
Yes, exactly. And then Sean will post a poll at the end of January for the February pick.
Okay.
And I guess probably for March too, if you guys want to read a book. But I thought we could just spend the whole hour talking about the club and books we met. And there's a really nice thread about what people want to talk about. So we'll just have a really fun celebration to get back on the bandwagon.
And also during the hiatus, I'll be sure to tweet and post things on our Facebook of other fan clubs, other Vaginal Fantasy fan clubs, if they're doing videos, if they're posting stuff. So at least you guys can still be watching things, even if it's not us during the hiatus. Because there's great groups, like Felicia mentioned at the beginning of every one of these episodes. There's great groups that actually are doing some YouTube videos. So they're kind of fun to watch too.
Yep. Yeah. And also just create threads, like whatever book you're reading that month, other vaginal fantasy book people can enjoy. And we just love people discovering new books together. And it's kind of the point of the club. So awesome, you guys. I'll be back after I have this child. Not exactly.
Baby day.
Baby day.
Baby day. Nothing exciting to announce about it. It's happening and it'll be done.
Kyla came up with a really good name for the baby.
I did. It was Kyla Veronica Bonnie Day.
Okay. I made that That's tweet. Not the name. That's the tweet I made. Except it was Veronica Bonnie Kyla Day.
Yeah. Oh, see.
Oh, okay. That sounds better to me.
And if you want to put if you want to put Sophie's name in there, you know, just as like, because she's looking at you right now, very judgy.
She's pretty judgy.
You can't There's be in the harem, Sophie. Guys. Sorry.
They're like, tell us about the baby. It's a baby. It's a girl. She's going to be born. I won't be posting pictures of her. She gets her name when she's born. Nobody knows it.
Yay!
And that's it. That's it.
Wait,
it'll be fine.
Okay, that's fine. But you have to.
I'm not telling. My dad doesn't even know. Like nobody knows.
I love that. If it makes you feel better, that's how I was named. My parents did not settle on a name until I was born.
Oh no, I know the name. I just don't want to tell anybody. I don't want the judgment. People are so judgy.
No, they're very judgy. I understand. No.
Okay. Yay. Anyway, all right. Bye, guys. We'll see you in March, and I'll be on the forums talking. You know, and thank you so much for being part of this group. 5 years.
We love you. 5 years.
Woohoo! Bye.